years ago. Poverty rates have been reduced so dramatically that now anti-capitalists say the trouble with capitalism is that it makes us too affluent. Now excess wealth has suddenly replaced poverty as the tragic flaw of capitalism. I, for one, as someone who believes we should help the poor, think that's one problem I can put up with. Okay, now I'm going to switch gears and go into the third and last part of my presentation, dealing with a few common anti-capitalist critiques. What I'm about to show you in the next 5 minutes will immediately lay to rest about 80% of the specious objections I hear to capitalism. If I am to make any converts here tonight, it will be in this section, precisely because I won't have to convert you, only give proper names to the principles you already hold. I'm going to share with you two fallacies that the great majority of people discussing capitalism, including many scholars untrained in economics, fall prey to, and in so doing, absolutely discredit themselves in the eyes of any economist. Once you are aware of these two fallacies and avoid them, you will be able to discuss and debate economics in an honest, intelligent, and respectable manner without using arguments that would, quite frankly, be an embarrassment if encountered in any professional discourse. Pay close attention, because most of the arguments against capitalism that I hear fall apart once you understand these two errors. Number one is calling something its opposite. War is peace, freedom is slavery, ignorance is strength. This is what George Orwell termed doublespeak, which is simply the notion that if you say something often enough, you can convince people that something is its opposite. I think it's formally known as the equivocation fallacy. And the second one is the false dilemma, the either-or fallacy, where you are falsely presented with only two choices. I think of Bush's infamous speech where he said, you are either with us, meaning you support all his wars, or you're with the terrorists. There might be another option. These two fallacies are everywhere, permeating political language, confusing our conversations with one another, and making any real beneficial discourse almost impossible. Let's just consider for a moment how they have confused the war and peace debate. In 1948, with two horrifying world wars barely behind them, the U.S. government changed the name of the Department of War to the Department of Defense. It seems the world had had enough of war and had embarked on a new era of waging peace. Now, instead of soldier war makers, we have peacekeepers. Instead of weapons of war, we have weapons of peace. I looked up exactly what these weapons of peace might look like and thought you might enjoy seeing some yourself. These are all real. We have the Colt Peacemaker, the Peacekeeper Knife, the Peacemaker Cannon, Peacekeeper Tanks, the Big Bad and Beautiful B-36 Peacemaker Bomber, the U.S. Peacekeeper Missile, no joke, that's its name, Peaceful Nukes, and maybe that's not real, and of course the Nobel Peace Prize winner. Maybe Orwell was right. War is peace. But what if you disagree with bombing for peace? What? Don't you know we're fighting for peace? Clearly, if you reject my proposed peacekeeping, you must be a warmongering, peace-hating, child-killing sicko. I think we can all see quite clearly that calling war peace does not make it so. It's doublespeak. It's calling something its opposite. And that rejecting someone's proposed means of peacekeeping does not mean you hate peace. That's a false dilemma. Now let's investigate how these fallacies permeate the economic debate as well. In what has been called the anti-capitalist Bible, Naomi Klein's popular bestseller, The Shock Doctrine, delivers a scathing critique of corrupt, bought-out politicians providing monopoly grants to corporations, state privileges and subsidies to big businesses, exploitation of the poor through fraud and violence, corporation-led wars, torture, dictatorship supported and favored by mega-businesses, etc., etc., and at the end of the day calls it all capitalism, having just described the exact opposite of capitalism, which holds to an absolute separation of the market and the state violence. So why the intellectual dishonesty, the doublespeak, calling things the opposite of what they are? Most of what people critique as capitalism is in fact precisely the opposite of capitalism. It is no different than calling war peace. It is pure doublespeak and a fallacy. It is fascinating to think that most megacorporations who owe their whole fortune to the exploitative political violence of bailouts, subsidies, lucrative government contracts, etc., are perfectly happy to have their revolting behavior characterized by the common man as free market capitalism, because the people, repulsed by the disease, call for what is cleverly misnamed as the cure, which is only more disease disguised in doublespeak. Outraged with corporations using violence, call on the state, the very locus of violence, to abolish the free market, where violence is prohibited. It's through this clever deception that we have these Occupy Wall Street guys calling on the government to save them from the evil capitalist banks, the very banks who owe their very existence to the state. On a free market, they would all have failed for their reckless behavior. If these guys really want these banks to die, they should be calling for the free market, where the banks can no longer privatize their profits and socialize their losses by using the state apparatus to exploit taxpayers. Secondly, just as rejecting someone's proposed peacekeeping methods does not mean you hate peace, so my rejection of someone's proposed means of providing for the poor via government redistribution of wealth or whatever does not mean that I hate the poor and am a self-centered sicko who enjoys seeing the sick suffer without health care. Both of these are false dilemmas and must be abandoned in order to have an honest and intelligent conversation, whether it be on the best means of achieving peace or the best means of providing for the poor. So double speak and false dilemma. This seriously sums up most of the arguments I hear against capitalism, and in as much as they employ these fallacies, they are unequivocally bogus. There are many other good questions I hope we can discuss more later on. Questions about capitalism and monopoly, economic power, the environment, etc. But I couldn't quite get it all in a half-hour speech. But my hope tonight is simply that this will give you a clear picture of what capitalism is and what it is not, laying the foundation for many future discussions of capitalism and the kind of world we who seek the kingdom of God should embrace. So, if you could start a civilization from scratch, what kind of world would you want? We have two and only two choices in how we build our relationships to one other. And I will maintain that this is not a false dilemma, as any aberration from the free market necessarily involves violence. Every economic system falls somewhere on that scale. So how do we organize our relationships on the service, the voluntary principle of free markets, or on the exploitation and theft principle? We have the service principle here, which is the economic means, which I explained, or the hegemonic principle, which is the political means. We have individual freedom versus coercion, mutual benefit versus exploitation, as one benefits at the expense of another, mutual harmony versus caste conflict, peace versus war, incentives for production resulting in an increase in the standard of living versus incentives for theft and not producing, which tends towards poverty. If you remember nothing else in any discussion of economics, simply ask yourself, what creates wealth, production or theft? What do I think is the place of violence in the marketplace? Your answers to these questions will ultimately determine your entire position. I propose that we abandon all forms of violence toward one another and follow in Christ's footsteps of service to one another. I hope you will consider joining me.